Greetings to you, River Church and friends. My name is Jason. I'm one of the pastors here at the River, and I want to give you just a short crash course in fasting. We are preparing ourselves for what we are calling Re-Up 21, which is an opportunity for us to return to Jesus, to reset our convictions, and to renew our covenant as God's chosen people. In light of all that's happening in the world, this feels so important for us right now. And so we're going to be taking 3 days next week, starting Monday to Wednesday, in a period of fasting. It's really a 48-hour period of fasting and praying and seeking God. And since fasting is not a discipline that all that many of us are very comfortable with or familiar with, I wanted to give you just a short overview of how to engage a fast. So let me share my screen, and I'm going to give you a couple key tips along the way. So I remember about 5-6 years ago, I was in a gas station parking lot, and I was on the phone with a mentor of mine, and I was just frustrated and grieved by sort of the state of my spiritual being. You know that experience when scripture is really stale? You know, you open it up and it is boring to read, or prayer just feels like there's static on the line. You know, it's like your Christianity, it's like you were watching a movie that you've seen just too many times. It's just familiar and stale. That's where I was at. And what was particularly difficult about it is that no matter what I tried to do, the things that I knew how to do in my toolkit, like get a new Bible reading plan or spend more time in worship, these things, they weren't helping. They weren't working. And so I was on the phone with this mentor, and he asked me a question. He said, "Jason, have you tried fasting?" And I told him about this experience I had, really the only time I had tried to fast, which was in high school. We did like a 24-hour fast for this justice awareness experience. And I remember eating a slice of pizza halfway through and feeling really guilty. And that was really my only experience with fasting up to this point. And so he just encouraged and commended me to try and explore this historical, tried and true discipline of the church that has a tremendous amount of power. So let me tell you a little bit about how fasting can be a powerful discipline. At its core, fasting is about making space for God. This happens when we let go of an appetite. It's often food, it doesn't have to be, but it's the things that give us pleasure. And in its absence, we are intentionally attending to God in his presence. And what happens here, and this is the reminder that we are truly full embodied people, we have a connection between our body and our soul, that the physical awareness of that emptiness, in this case, maybe an empty stomach, is a reminder to turn to Jesus, to turn from the things that we depend on, and to turn back to Jesus. One author puts it this way. He says that fasting clears us out and opens us up to intentionally seeking God's will and grace in a way that goes beyond normal habits of worship and prayer. What I think is most poignant for us is that last bit, goes beyond normal habits of worship and prayer. I don't think many of us have a regular rhythm of fasting, but that's not always been the case in the church. In fact, throughout the ages, many saints have fasted regularly a day or two a week throughout their entire lifetime. So there is a weakness in our Western contemporary discipleship that doesn't know how to engage spiritual disciplines that create discomfort. And so I think this is an example for us where we can go beyond our normal habits of worship and prayer to intentionally seek God. There's a lot I could say about how we see fasting in scripture, but I've picked a few highlights just to show us some of what fasting can do or what it can accomplish. Number one, fasting in the life of the Old Testament and New Testament people of God was a regular practice. We see in Matthew 6 that Jesus himself begins by saying, "When you fast," and then he lists out some prescription for how to do it. He doesn't say if you fast. So the environment that Jesus was in, certainly in the Old Testament, there was a precedent for the people of God had a regular discipline of fasting. Fasting can be really significant for rekindling intimacy with God. We know in Revelation, this language in Revelation 2 of rediscovering your first love. And that's kind of what I'm talking about in the beginning of my story of wanting, you know, to come out of this stale place with God. It can be a significant way to sort of reset us. Fasting has a humbling quality to it. In the Psalms, we see this again and again, and specifically in Psalm 35, David says, "I humbled myself with fasting." So it's a way in which we recognize that we are dependent upon God for all things. And as we come present with the cravings and appetites that we have, it can reveal our true condition, the things that we latch onto that are not Jesus, that have become maybe idols in our life. And this can lead us to repentance. I like to say that fasting microwaves your faith, that it turbocharges it. It makes you sensitive again to the word of God and sensitive again to the presence of God. And fasting can have a private or a communal corporate dimension to it. You know, in Matthew 6, Jesus is giving instructions for how to fast privately, that you would not make a big show of it, but that you would make it sort of an experience between you and God. But it can also be a very communal thing. We see again and again that the people of God, when there were significant moments of crisis or need, would go before God as a body and fast. And that's a little bit of how the posture we're going to be taking as we come up to Re-Up 21. How we come to fasting matters. Our motives matter. So there can be good ways and bad ways about how we would approach it. Some not so good reasons to fast would be to be seen by others. Anytime we seek personal piety and the recognition of others, well, we're scratching at something that really only God can give. So we don't want to come to fast to be seen as holy. It doesn't help us to be justified. Like, we don't need to atone for something. And fasting is very much tied to repentance. And that's a part of how we're going to be engaging next week. But we need to remember the heart of the gospel, which is that we are already covered, and all of our mistakes and sins and failures as a people and as the church have been covered by Jesus on the cross. So fasting will not justify us. And nor is fasting something we do to earn God's favor, that if we eat food or we don't eat food does not change how God feels towards us. Some better reasons to fast would be to take a posture of repentance, to awaken and stir that spiritual hunger, to replace the things that we normally go to feel good and to find that our souls get aggravated and agitated to be hungry for God, to test and see what maybe is a master over us and replace it with Jesus, to forfeit good things and go after the best things in God, to divide our bread with the poor, that actually in scriptures we see that fasting, in Isaiah in particular, is a call to relinquish the things that we have, in this case, food, to give away to others. It can be an example for why that'd be a good thing to do. Finally, to express our ache for Jesus's return and for the kingdom to come. So I think the first and the last are the clearest reasons why we're engaging our fast as a church body next week, that we are being called into a spirit of repentance and we are aching for Jesus's return in his kingdom to reign, where we see so much of the earthly kingdom reigning in its place. So let me end by getting really practical. I want to talk about what to do before, during, and after your experience of fasting. So before, as we come up to our fast beginning next Monday, I invite you to pick your focus. So food is what has been done traditionally, and that is our ask that if you're able, that you would consider doing a food fast. I'll say a little bit more about that in a moment. But here are a whole list of other things you could consider giving up. And some of these, I don't know how many of us are riding elevators these days, but some of these are just to show you the creativity and the breadth of, there's a lot of flexibility for you to choose with the Spirit of God, something that is going to stretch you, but that feels that you may feel that you are capable of accomplishing. If you're engaging in any kind of a food fast, partial or full food fast, you should consider your physical and mental health, as particularly if you have a complicated relationship to food or you have a physical condition you're monitoring, if you're a nursing mother, there are good reasons why to abstain from a food fast. Also, not in this case per se, but in the future, if you're considering fasting for extended periods of time, it's always helpful to consult with your doctor. You want to commit your time frame. We've kind of helped you with that. We're saying Monday night, 7 p.m. to Wednesday night, 7 p.m., but get clear for yourself how you're going to interact with that. And finally, you want to be attentive ahead of time. Be proactive about your schedule. A 48-hour food fast, it will be a little bit uncomfortable, and you'll probably have a headache, especially as you're coming off of maybe caffeine or sugar. You'll probably feel tired, maybe irritable. So do your best that you can to manage your responsibilities at work, at home, with your family, to give yourself space. And the best way to do that is during your fast, spend the time that you would usually be eating with the Lord. If you have a family and kids that need to eat, don't neglect them. Make sure they're eating and cook for them, but replace that time. Find a way to steal away 20, 30 minutes to read scripture, to sit with the Lord, that our fasting will be powerful as we connect with God. We're going to try to help you with that. Monday night, Tuesday night, Wednesday night, we're going to have 3 hours of various ways to gather on Zoom. And I'll say more about that at the very end. Take note of what God's doing and speaking to you in your journal. Drink lots of water. That will be really important and really helpful. And be expectant. That fasting, be expectant of both sides of the coin, that it will be uncomfortable. And as American Christians, we are not accustomed to being uncomfortable very often, but expect to be a little bit, agitated and uncomfortable, groggy, whatever. Just know that you are going to experience things very viscerally in your body, but also be expectant for spiritual breakthrough. And it's often been the case for me that the breakthrough comes on the back end of the fast, that maybe in the days to come, that it is like putting your faith in the microwave, and then there's the hot meal of a new spirituality on the back end. Finally, as you come out of the fasting experience, resist the temptation to indulge. If you are fasting food, try not to have a giant feast on Wednesday night. Let your body re-enter slowly. Also, if you're fasting a different focus, like media, don't just flip on the news right when you come back to it. Allow yourself to enter back in with some wisdom and patience. Also, it's helpful to process your experience, to be able to talk with others that know and love you and share about what God is doing and stirring in you during your time of fasting. So I invite you to consider a couple questions this week as we lead into our time of fasting next week. I wonder what might excite you about the prospect of fasting? What maybe gives you pause or makes you feel concerned? And what questions does it bring up? If you have any questions and you would like some guidance or to process with someone, you can email me at jason@the-river.org, and I'd love to help prepare you well to set you up to have a great experience. So finally, as we come to our experience next week, Re-Up 21, let me say a couple of things. We are going to be fasting for 48-hour period as a whole church community. We're inviting and calling all of us into this experience. And it'll begin Monday at 7, concluding on Wednesday at 7 p.m. For many of us, we'll be able to engage a full food fast. And that, just to be clear on what that means, that's really clear liquids only. So even avoiding things like coffee or milk, trying to maybe have some light herbal teas and water, broth, if that help is helpful for you. That would be what we consider a full food fast. Some of us will be able to do that. Others of us might want to try, especially if we're new to fasting, some sort of a partial or a modified food fast. This could include modifying your diet. So you could try giving up meat, sugar, caffeine. It could also try modifying the schedule. You could try going a sunrise to sunset food fast. So you're eating maybe a very early breakfast and a very late dinner, but you're sort of from 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. or 6 p.m. or whatever, you are withholding from eating. That could be another way to explore trying. And of course, for some of us, food is not going to be the right option. And don't feel bad about that, but there are plenty of ways to engage this. Feel the freedom, the flexibility. We want you to enter in the best way that you know how into a fast. So that might be some of the other things we talked about. And because fasting and prayer go hand in hand, we're going to be having gatherings on Zoom Monday night, Tuesday night, Wednesday night from 7 to 10. Each night, there will be a slightly different emphasis per the hour. So from 7 to 8, we'll have time for musical worship and processing, sharing about what's happening in us and in our society. We'll be having time from 8 to 9 for lamenting, confession, and repentance. And then our closing hour from 9 to 10 will be looking outward, interceding for the church, for the world, and stirring and meditating on what Martin Luther King called a vision of the beloved community, a vision for a healthy society where the kingdom is at the center. So that's a little bit about how to engage the fast. And if you have any needs or questions, feel free to contact me or any of the church staff. And we are really excited for how God is going to meet us as we enter in as a body, linking arms, stirring and returning to Jesus, resetting our convictions on him and seeking God for his renewal.